back.
Morning.
Good morning, coffee. Oh, and Brent and Deb.
Good morning.
I feel like my coffee got weak today. Good morning. Happy Wednesday, everybody.
I hope everybody has their coffee this morning because we're going to make your brains hurt a little bit. We're going to talk about game thinking. Everybody thinks it's all about fun, but really, it's serious business.
Yes. No fun here. No fun.
No fun. 1 year.
Yep. Stop the fun now.
Looks like we've got some graphical avatars in the chat room there, which is probably new and never hung out with us before. So welcome, newbies. Good to see you.
Yeah, welcome aboard, and thank you for being idiotic with us.
It's a good day to be. Hey, you know, we've got a familiar face with us today, Chris. Who's hanging out with us in the middle square?
In the middle square? as long as nobody's looking on their mobile phone, which in case it might have rotated. I don't know. Well, no, it still could be the middle, I guess. They're vertically.
Yeah.
See, we all need more coffee. We have the inimitable. Oh, Jack says I'm in the middle. Well, there we go. Monkey in the middle. Anyway, we have Deb Thomas here with us. Deb was with us a couple of weeks ago, along with Kevin and Carl, talking about the project that they've got going on in Orlando, the 1 week sort of game related camp and step away.
Step away, design.
Yeah. But Deb's come back with us today to talk a little bit more about some more stuff in the game related area. Maybe Deb, just for the folks who missed us the first time around, just give us a quick intro and a quick bit of your background.
Okay, sure. So, you know what? I'm going to start with my early entry into what got me into the game design field. So I started off as a newspaper reporter, and I had an education. My degree was in education and in journalism. So I started writing for the newspaper. I wrote for the education column. It was a big paper, but a small town. It was one of their bureaus. And anyway, one of the things I had to do was interview the county health director on a regular basis. I had to look at the restaurants, you know, issues and all of that. And but I also looked for feature articles. So one time I walked into a game store, and I found the county health director's name and phone number on a bulletin board in that game store. So when I got back to my office, and he was looking for someone to play Avalon Hill games with him. And I didn't know what an Avalon Hill game was. So I got back to the office and I called him and said, I just saw your name on a bulletin board. What's up with that? So he starts telling me about these games, and they're strategic war games, and they're very complicated. So that's why you don't just ask your neighbor, hey, you want to play a board game tonight? So anyway, I ended up doing a big newspaper spread about his games and some other. There was a topical issue. It was way back when Dungeons and Dragons was just coming out, so there was some, you know, controversy about the game. And so anyway, I kind of tied a bunch of things together and did this 2-page spread, and I thought for sure he would find like people knocking his door down to play these games, the game with him. And I don't know. So weeks and weeks and months go by, and I call him every time I need to. And but one time I realized, hey, I should find out if he ever found anyone to play. So I asked, and he said no. Well, by then I already knew how complicated the games are. So you have to do geometry in your head, and you know, all sorts. It's complicated. And he was playing the Arab-Israeli war games. I finally said, look, you know, I'll play, but I don't know if I'll be any good. But I ended up going to his house every Wednesday evening, and we would play these games, and his wife was studying piano in the other room, she was practicing, and I just used to call it my Wednesday salon, because, you know, we would have a glass of wine, and I was learning how to play these games, and I was peace, not war, so Avalon Hill. And here I was playing this game, trying to play my strategy, which was don't shoot, hide. So here I was in the desert, and I would try to hide. So, you know, and the bushes were few and far between, but my goal was always to try to get to a bush to hide from, you know, overhead fire. And, you know, it wasn't working for me. So eventually I started seeing my behavior change, and I was learning about war and about the geography and about so many things that it light bulbs went off. And, but it wasn't until he came one time, he told me he was building a game, and he came out with this paper game, you know, pulled it out of the tube and like unrolled this paper-based game that he was designing. And that's when it hit me. I was like, I didn't know you were just allowed to make a game. So that was when I decided I'm going to someday somehow start making games. And then when I moved into the training industry, I started adding game elements to my training to, you know, add some intrigue and interest and learning. And I already knew that it could help you kind of focus on the content and change your behavior. So that's how I got into it.
Well, that's your origin story, and that's how you became, yes, a superhero.
but it wasn't until, 15 years ago then I started my company, Silly Monkey. I had done some corporate gigs and, you know, things like that. And it was a layoff that kind of prompted me to, like, try it. And it was, you know, at first people were like, who's your client going to be? I mean, they didn't even have a plural. Do you have a client? So, because game was not wasn't an exciting learning word at that point yet. It was a little frightening.
A pretty foreign concept. Just that we were joking about no fun here, but I mean, game and gamification, those sorts of things sound like you're trivializing something.
Right.
If you come from a perspective of things are serious around here.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Right.
For sure.
Exactly.
Yeah, it seems like we need to get away from that word, because that seems to be the sticking point with a lot of people, is just the word itself. I think people get it once you show it to them. But if you just tell people, you know, yes, we're going to play a game, for some reason, play and game seems to be the opposite of work. And so if you're playing, you're not working. And in fact, it's quite the opposite, because we know that if you're playing a game, you are likely learning, because that's what a good game is all about, is learning. But it can be tricky too, because a lot of people have sort of spoiled it for us already with bad games.
Right. But you know, they've spoiled traditional training for us too, right?
There's no bad training.
Right, with crazy PowerPoints and blah and talk until, you know, you go into a coma until they ask a question and they, so it's true though. Some of the really early poorly designed like icebreakers and games like that just didn't tie with content whatsoever. People were like, no, we don't have time for that. We're trying to shrink the training time, and we need to just get straight to the content. So stop with the fluff. And they were right about that part. I mean, as far as, right?
Yeah, you're right. And it's, but I think what we're going to talk about a little bit here today is a little bit different than, like, I think some people might assume that we're talking about gamification, but what we're talking about is really thinking differently and game thinking when it comes to designing our instruction. And
right.
So we can do this without having to use the words. So give us a little bit of a setup, if you will, as to how people maybe can start thinking game thinking.
Yeah, you know, so when I first started my company, I was, some people did come to me and say, hey, we do want to make a game. And I already have the courses already made. It's already built. You're just going to use that content. And I can't tell you how many times I would take the content and realize that there's nothing here. You have a lot of PowerPoint slides, but a lot of it is the same, only said differently, or, you know, just there wasn't any meat to it. And it occurred to me then that game design is a really great litmus test for whether you have content for a course. And partly because, you know, if you're thinking like a game designer, you need to think about, you know, how are they going to win the game? So even if you're not going to design a game, you're just designing a course, a traditional course. But if you think about how do they win, if we were designing a game, then that winning component or that victory condition should be tied to the content. So it shouldn't be just because they collect all these points, now they won, unless the points had something to do with collecting resources that were required during the behavior that you want them to display during on the job or whatever it is that you're, you know, teaching them. So if you can think about things like the game concepts while you're designing it can help you get to that place. So especially victory conditions are great for it. Like maybe you don't want them to collect, you know, you want them to avoid threats, for instance, because when they collect too many bad scores from a customer, you know, if they're doing customer service and customers are getting, you know, angry with them, that's not good, right? So during the game, you can have them collecting these, you know, bad points that would require them to then be the loser. Yeah, I don't like to say loser in a game, in a training game, but you know, it's the way it is. But yeah, so if they're collecting things that are relevant or trying to avoid things that are relevant, then you're tying things to the actual content. And that's the critical piece. And what you were talking about earlier with poorly designed games, a lot of times it's game mechanics that are in place, but they don't have really anything to do with the content that is the point of the learning.
Hmm. The phrase victory conditions is almost, even though we're talking about how the word game might put off people somewhat, but victory conditions, you think about, you know, winning. Well, I mean, the goal of training is to help everybody win. You want to help the employee get better and therefore improve the organization. So, you know, everything then does become a win in that way. So that's an interesting phrase to think of, or an interesting phrase to think about maybe including in a discussion, say with management teams or SMEs or whoever is trying to understand this transition. Victory conditions.
Right.
Yeah,
right.
We see profits go up, or we see reduced call time, or whatever the right. You know, whatever that measurement is, which is exactly what we should be, you know, working towards simply, you know, anyway, with anything that we're putting together to train people. So
right.
I like that phrase. That's going in the notebook.
It's going in the archives.
No, not the archives. That's for storing stuff we don't need now. That's going in my active notebook.
Ooh, active. Awesome.
Cool. So what are some of the other, like, that seems to me that's a pretty good, you know, metaphor or filter then for thinking about things that we do already, but maybe fine tuning or improving right. that kind of thing. Are there some other aspects then of game thinking that provide similar filters for other aspects or portions of the process of putting together a training program?
Right. Yes. Good. Great question. So one of the reasons that gamification and games are compelling is because they kind of feed into our core compulsion. So like victory condition, people want to win, right? That's why competition. I mean, we have big games going on right now that everybody's tuned into, and that's endless, right? We're just always like watching some sort of game being played out, and people, even if you know, I'm not a huge sports fan, but I get pulled into, you know, basketball, football, all of them. I get pulled in when I, after a while, I start to know who's playing, who's winning, who's, you know, I start to become really interested in the country or the team or the whatever. But it's because of these core compulsions that games work in the first place. So for instance, so that's one of the ways you can think about games and learning. And core compulsions would include things like competition, but also collecting, that, think Pokemon. We want to, people want to collect those little things, you know, they or trading stamps or cards or whatever. People love to collect things, and they want the whole set. And so that's one of our core compulsions. So if you know, if somebody gave you two of something and you know there's two more that match the whole set, you want to go buy it. You're like, next thing you know, you're at the store or on Amazon trying to find the rest of your set.
Beanie babies.
Yeah, exactly.
Gas station glasses. I mean, really.
Really dumb things sometimes. We just want the whole set. And so definitely collecting is important. That's why it's a game component that is important for, you know, to include if it makes sense with the learning objective. So if you want them to find, you know, to learn all the process steps of whatever, you need them to go find those steps, then they're out collecting the information, but it's relevant to the learning. So you don't want to give them like a fireman's hat for winning this piece in the game that has nothing to do with the actual learning that's going on. So the collecting needs to tie to it. So all of these things need to tie to the learning objectives. So another core compulsion would be chaos, creating order out of chaos. So that's like Bejeweled, you know, if you think about that game, all of a sudden you start wanting to like just organize those things, and you play longer than you mean to. You think, well, I'm just going to play while I'm sitting here waiting on this, you know, attendant to help me. And then they interrupt you. Because it's your turn to go to the counter. Like, oh, I almost won, and now they interrupted me. So collecting is good, but putting things in order is great for us as learning designers, because we need people to know how things should be and what placement they should be in, or, you know, there's so many ways to use that concept. Let's see, what are some of the other exploration is a core compulsion. So and that's why if we can give them like an e-learning activity where they just go off and find things that we're kind of guiding them to find, people love to go on explorations. So, and then collect the prizes.
Those are great. All of those things are great for like onboarding and things like that. When you do, like, I don't think scavenger hunt really is the right word, but it's kind of like that. I've seen people do use the I want to say like QR codes and things like that, and then they develop a little onboarding program where you have to go find all the QR codes around the manufacturing facility or whatever, and then, you know, you scan it tells you a little bit of something about that area or the person that sits in that cubicle, and then you go on to the next one, and then when you collect all the right things, then you've been onboarded, and it ends you up at your desk or your particular place where you're going to be,
right?
And, you know, I always thought that was interesting, but only like you were saying before, you have to know your audience, and it works for some people, not for others. Like, you're not going to hire a new CEO and say, hey, go play this game. You know.
Right. You have to think of your audience, but also you have to think of the content. Like, what is it they're looking for? Does it make sense to go look for stuff you're going to give them, or, you know, so yeah, some new employees, you might want them to go find where the printer is, how to use the printer could be part of it. So that would be one thing I would include in, you know, even an onboarding scavenger hunt using QR codes. I'd want to make sure that not just finding it, like learning how to use that room or what that person does and how, when, you know, maybe you have to go find the IT department because if, you know, you have IT issues, you know where to go. And then while you're there, find out, what is it I do? How do I, you log into your IT system to, you know, make my request for whatever my problem is. So, yeah.
Yeah, Michelle reminds me with a comment. She says percent completion bars are another version of that. And it reminds me that it, like, feedback is a way of game thinking, right? It's important for us to be able to give our learners feedback. And games are great at giving the players feedback because that's what keeps the game moving on. You make a move, then something in the game happens. Everybody that's playing the game together knows and gets that feedback, you know, what the reaction was to somebody's action within the game. And I think right. that's one thing that we sometimes forget when we're creating, especially self-paced learning, you know, you have to give people visual cues or some sort of feedback when they take an action. And yeah, those completion bars, progress bars, things like that. It's a simple little mechanic, but at the same right. time, it's very important, right?
Very, yes. And I mean, I've sat on e-learning courses, compliance or whatever, that I've had to take. And if they don't tell me how long the course is or how close I am to being finished, I start going crazy after a minute or two. You know, 20 minutes in, you're like, gosh, am I, how close am I to finishing this thing? And if you know, like, oh, it's only 5 more minutes, like, oh, okay, I can do this. Or if you know it's 2 hours, then you're think, okay, my meeting's at, you know, yeah, you need to know how far, how close you are to completing. So I love that, that comment about the completion bars. It's a goal. It's like when I log into my LinkedIn profile, I purposely haven't finished all of my profile information, but it bothers me every single time because LinkedIn tells me that I'm only 75% complete. So it is, and it is another core compulsion for sure. Yeah, that's a good one.
Yeah, we see that. We see a lot of these things in places other than training. I mean, we were talking about the gas station glasses, you know, that or collecting all the spoons, like silly things, but that need to, as you say, complete a set and then bringing you back, or that taunt really of 75% completed. Oh, I'm not perfect yet, right?
Right.
And even as you said, you've got the logical decision that you've made to not do all of the LinkedIn. You know, you're doing that on purpose, and yet that little thing gets there and triggers you.
So. I might end up finishing it someday and just be done with it. But I was thinking that very thing this morning when I was thinking about doing this this event with you. I started thinking about, do you remember the green stamps? Are you guys old enough?
Yeah.
You know, maybe some people are old enough on the call to remember collecting green stamps. So I remember my mother collecting. She would go to only stores that gave you the green stamps, and they would give you the books, and then I was the person who had to lick them and put them in the book, and I would go with her to the store to, you know, collect the prize because there were televisions and toasters and lamps, and I can't remember everything.
There was a special store in our neighborhood that we would go to with all the books, a big stack of the books, and we'd walk down the store and see what we could buy with all the books.
Right, right. And sometimes we would leave because my mother would realize, oh, if I go home and collect 3 more books, I can get this other thing. So I'm going to go do that, and then I'll come back. So, yeah.
Yeah, it is interesting. One of the things that strikes me about what we do is we do simulations really well in the training industry, and a lot of times that's what games are, is just mini versions and safe environments for us to learn and fail and to be able to experiment and, you know, with new ideas and things like that. That's part of game thinking, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I think I do a lot of simulation board games. So, you know, I was thinking about one of the components a lot of people like to tell you that you should think of when you design a game is the first thing is maybe your theme. You know, is it going to be a superhero theme or is it, you know, zombie game or whatever? But a simulation actually has a theme. It's the work. It is the, it's the company. And it's absolutely a game. As far as, you know, people are moving through whatever progress they need to take and collecting things or avoiding things and all of that stuff. So yeah, simulation is a perfect, design for a game, I think. And that's one that a lot of companies like because it is, doesn't look like a game. Yeah. And I can make it a little, like a lot of times clients will let me make it a little more playful looking. As long as, you know, you stick with corporate colors and branding and so forth. So you can kind of start to introduce some of those more playful components to the design. But yeah, the game and the game doesn't have to be, and it shouldn't be a lot of times super detailed as far as that simulation is concerned, because that can bog it down. But of course, it depends on the topic and what the game goal is or the objectives of the learning, because do you want them to get go do a deep dive into some aspect of this, you know, system that we're teaching, or do you want this over just more like an overview, because maybe you have different departments that are working in silos and they really need to know how they impact somebody downstream or upstream. So it can be more of an overview simulation at that point. So
yeah, yeah. We were mentioning earlier the sort of icebreaker games and the, well, gosh, if they're not relevant, well, a simulation is by default relevant because it is right. The thing, you know, it's the context, it is the work, it is the task right there. So that's like almost a zero barrier right. From that right. Perspective of relevant, you know, the relevance is baked in right from the very start.
Right. Yeah. So if you want to avoid the word game, although people are using it more now and it's not as, you know, it's not the dirty little four letter word anymore, but if you want to avoid that word, definitely you can just say, I want to build a simulation board activity. I don't know how you would finish that
right.
Sentence.
Yeah, you can call it an experience too, right? And I think people understand. I think another game thinking element and something that struck me a while back was the idea of what is fun and how is it that game designers get to fun? Like, why is one game more fun than another game, right? What brings us right. That joy? And one of the things that I that has stuck with me for a very long time is finding that balance between too difficult and too easy and right. Keeping the player right in that zone of, oh, I know I could do it if I just had one more chance. And they try again and then they try again. And I think sometimes in our work, we have a tendency to just try to make things too easy.
And it's or too hard.
Yeah, or too hard. And it's to find that nice little balance to keep people in that perfect middle zone of continuing to want to learn and to get more out of the experience is tough. But it's, it's something that has always stuck with me. And I always strive for that when I'm creating, any sort of learning experience.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that balance is really tricky, but that's where playtesting comes in. So, we used to do it even with e-learning. We would watch people: are they clicking on the right thing? Are they getting the answers that we want them to? Are they what are they missing? We would do a lot of testing to see, you know, if our learning design is working. And games kind of force you to do that. So you really should do some play testing, and you can see where people are getting bogged down and where the, like, they're loud and crazy. And then it's like, you know, falling asleep because now you have one person reading a long card that they can't figure out, and you've bogged it down. So that's working on the balance is the tricky. It's the secret sauce for sure.
Yeah. It's like a good dungeon master in doing Dungeons and Dragons, right? Doesn't just send the dragon right off the bat and crush the whole team. Because then what fun is that, right?
Right.
Leave the dragon and the crushing for the end. That's
right. Bye.
Yeah. Because then you learn stuff along the way.
Got to build up to something.
A great question about dull topics and how do we use game thinking to improve a dull topic and maybe make it fun. She's doing a project on billing and invoicing. Whew, that sounds compelling and beginning of itself.
Well, so that's a fantastic question. So, you know, what happens when they get it wrong? Like the person doing this work, is somebody going to lose money? Is somebody, what are the consequences of doing it correctly and getting it wrong on the job? So that's where you can build in the fun. And it's really, especially if you can show that, holy cow, you could bring a whole department down. People could lose their jobs, or you could lose money on Wall Street. If, you know, I mean, whatever it is, I don't know how, you know, I don't know if that maybe that much about billing and whatever, but I do know that there's things that happen. There's consequences in doing those jobs that's that whole idea of whatever. I'm just going to put in this number because I don't know. I can't figure it out. I'm just going to move on. Nobody's helping me. I'm done with this. But if you teach that in a game course, that if they did that, something horrible happens, then they might start to see that, oh my gosh, everything I do is really, really important. It's critical for the company. And I start to feel better about my role in the company.
Yeah, consequences, feedback, context in that. It does seem sort of like, if it's sales, there's a competitive streak in there by nature in that audience, probably, to a certain extent, for sure. And it doesn't mean, what we're talking about here isn't necessarily that you need to turn everything into a game either. But if you use some of these ideas as filters as you go and say, okay, how does this align? What are we doing here? But go back to victory objectives. I mean, you were describing the inverse of objectives. What are the consequences? But the victory objectives are, hey, if we do it right, these things improve, et cetera. I mean, we've always had, or for a long time, we've had that what's in it for me at the start of a course, or that concept that we've often encouraged people to include. And it strikes me as that's kind of related to a victory objective, that kind of approach too.
Right. Absolutely. Right.
Yeah. The victory conditions are something we should all strive for and tie those in for sure. But it is just that, just to kind of, wrap the whole conversation up in a bow. It isn't necessarily about making a game. It's just about thinking about how would you make it into a game and applying some of those thoughts or some of the things you would do to make another game to just improve and to make sure that you're making the best instruction that you can and just apply those thoughts to it.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know, which is, yes, a good one today. Hey, you know what? Before we start to run out of time too much, if people want to really stretch their game thinking muscles, you and Carl and Kevin have an event coming up, and I'd hate to let you go without giving you a chance to tell everybody in our chat today about what you guys are doing to help people game think better.
Yes, thank you. Yes, so we have an event coming up in September, September 15th through the 20th, and it is called Step Away. It's going to be in a little place near Orlando called Groveland, Florida. But this place is designed, every room is designed like a game. So a different type of game, like there's a Monopoly game and a Lego game, I believe. I forget. There's every Scrabble. There's everything. And there's big board games outside built on the ground. There's just all sorts. And we're going to build some of those things into the event. But what we're going to do is have some sessions where we talk about game thinking, innovation, story design, and then have people work through creating a card game. They're going to also learn how to build a board game or any type of game, but they're going to finish a board game that week. I mean, a card game that week. And they're going to finish a little kind of comic book or a graphic story, and they're going to learn all of the things that are required to build, to prototype, to design, prototype, test it, and then at the end we're going to send their components off and have them published. When they get home, they'll have their card game will show up in the mail, and same with their little comic or graphic story. So we're super excited about it. There's just so much that's going to happen in this week that, you know, it's a full immersion, and that's why we're calling it Step Away. They're going to completely be able to kind of separate themselves from the, you know, our everyday life, which is complicated and taxing. And we don't always get this luxury of just thinking about some ideas that maybe we've wanted to try to play out. So it's called Step Away.
Cool. Very cool. And maybe also throw in the you know, the chat there, just info if people are looking to connect with you or to I don't know, check things out that you do. Throw some of that info in there into the chat too for us. We get so wrapped up sometimes in the conversation, and we forget to connect people outside of this conversation too. So let's not forget that.
Yeah, it sounds like there's a lot of folks doing some great work and have some opportunities to try to do some games. So I'll throw this out to the chat and just say to those of you that, first of all, thank you all for participating and dropping your questions into the chat and sharing with us some of the work that you're doing. It always makes this conversation so much more fun. And if you get a chance to apply some game thinking, you know, shoot us an email here and let us know what you're doing, and we'll talk about it. Yeah, we can have Deborah back on, or you know, we can follow up with you and have those conversations and extend this out a little bit further. So thanks.
Yeah, it'd be really cool to take some real world examples and bring this back and talk about them, and people can. We had some really, really cool thoughts going on here today, but seeing it in action is very awesome too. So,
yeah, it would be very cool to have people try things that they've been wanting to try, and then come back with, hey, this part didn't work, or this worked really well, and then kind of dissect it and figure out, like, why'd that work? Why didn't that work? And have that discussion. That'd be a lot of fun. Yeah.
Yeah, that'd be something we could all learn from for sure. Yeah. Very cool. As always, Deb, thanks so much for joining us. It's been an awesome conversation this morning. Hopefully the folks in the chat are joining us today have got a little pieces of stuff to take away. We see some neat comments in the chat saying that so it shows us that somebody's wheels are turning anyway, things that they might they want to pull with. So brilliant. Happy Wednesday, everybody, and we'll dance out of here.
Awesome. Thank you.
Sounds good, everybody. Thanks again, Deborah.
Music going.